Welcome back, everyone. My name is Darmadi Komo. I'm your host today. Hey, today I'm very happy to have Yos with me from SQL Server Engineering team. Yos, tell us who you are and what are you going to share with us today.
Thanks, Darmadi. So I'm a program manager on the SQL Server product team. And I have been working for the last couple of years on the in-memory OLTP feature. You may also know it under code name Hackathon. So I, like I said, I'm a program manager on the team, and my main focus area is looking at the T-SQL service area for development scenarios. So things like tables, how to access your tables, which queries to run, natively compiled stored procedures, etc. So today, what I want to talk about is in-memory OLTP for database developers. So it is this about like what do you need to know as a developer to use the in-memory OLTP feature? What are the new programming constructs and how you can use this feature in your application?
Okay, so to get everybody on the same page, do you mind do a recap on in-memory OLTP?
Yes, absolutely. First, let me kind of recount what things I'm going to cover, and then I will give a quick recap.
Okay.
So what I want to cover today is the basic constructs, the new tables and indexes. We have completely new table structures, new index structures, and you need to think about how to use those and how to access the queries, rather how to access the tables, which queries to run, how to execute your business processing logic most efficiently using in-memory OLTP. And finally, I want to talk about some tools that we are shipping with SQL 2014 to help you in using in-memory OLTP in your existing applications. So then, a brief recap for the new viewers who have not seen the first session, or maybe people who are watching the stream out of order later on from the website. So in-memory OLTP, what is it? It is a new feature in SQL Server 2014. It is in-memory technology that we are adding to boost the performance of specifically OLTP style workloads. Now, when we think about in-memory OLTP, we like to think about four architectural pillars that we have. So the first thing is a memory-optimized table and index structures. So we redesigned the data structures to store tables and to store and traverse indexes from the ground up with the table being in memory in mind. So if you assume that your table and your indexes are always in memory, it turns out that you can create your data structures and algorithms to access this data much more efficiently. So for example, we don't store rows on pages, but rows just exist in memory, and you can always just access them directly using an 8-byte memory pointer. The second thing is native compilation of your business processing logic. So because CPU clock rates are not going up very much, but we do want to do more and more work, we want to get the most out of our CPU cycles. So as it turns out, when you do regular query processing on a relational database system, there's quite a lot of work done in interpreting all the query constructs. So therefore, what we do is we take a stored procedure and we compile it directly to native code, directly to a DLL for optimal query execution. And then what we also notice is if you start scaling your machine, your CPU, to a large number of cores, there is going to be a lot of contention between these cores, which are all trying to access the same data. And the problem, one of the issues that is in currently the case with disk-based relational database systems, like in SQL Server, when you have your pages, you have ledges, you have locking going on. So our data structures and our algorithms are completely latch and lock free. So we scale a whole lot better when using memory optimized tables. It's almost linear. And finally, because TCO is always an important consideration, one important aspect of in-memory OLTP solution is that it is fully integrated into SQL Server. So you can use the same familiar tools like Management Studio, SQL Server Integration Service. You can use the same client libraries, all these things. There's integrated backup restore, integrated always on for high availability, etc.
That's cool. So now since this is a developer session, can you show us in more detail actually how to create the tables in in-memory OLTP?
That's a very good question, Dermadis. Actually, I was just going to talk about tables and indexes. Mm-hmm. So this statement that you see on the screen, this is a typical create table statement. This is actually a create table for a new memory-optimized table. Much of it looks very familiar. You have your create table, you have your columns, you have your same data types. But then there are a couple of things I want to call out in the statement that are new for memory optimized tables. So first off, there is the with option memory optimized on. So this is the basic option that you use to say that your table is memory optimized. Then we have the durability option. So in in-memory OLTP, tables can be either durable, which is the default, which means there's a persistent copy on disk, which is recovered during database restart. But there are also schema-only tables, which only exist in memory. So you don't have any log I/O, transactions are not being logged. So this is for cases where you can tolerate data loss and you want maximum performance. Then we have a new type of index, which is a hash index. This index is optimized for point lookups. I will give an example later on, but this is the syntax that we have. And a hash index, one thing to note is that you always need to specify a bucket count. The bucket count will tell you how large the index is going to be. And we generally recommend to use between 1 and 2 times the number of unique index key values as the bucket count. And then also important to note here is that with memory optimized tables, you specify all the indexes when you create the table. You don't create a table and then create the indexes. No, you specify the indexes in line when you create the table. And as you can see, the index that is used here is a non-clustered index, which is different from a hash index. It's specifically used for ordered scans and for range scans. More details about that later. Now, when you issue this create table statement, a number of things happen below the covers. So first, you issue the statement, for example, through Management Studio. You say create table, you execute. What happens in the back is that we generate code and we compile the code for this table. And in the end, we create a DLL. And this DLL is then loaded in memory, linked to the SQL Server process. Only at that time, we return control to the user.
Wow, this is good. I didn't know that there's actually DLL created for even tables. Can you actually show us where the DLLs are?
Yes, I will. Let me, in fact, show you an example of creating a table and also show you what's going on behind the scenes with the DLL.
Awesome.
So I have here a simple script. Let me first connect this to my server. Set up. Let me see if there's an existing database. I will drop it. So let me just create. Scrolling too much. Let me just create a simple SQL Server database, also OLTP. And now I want to enable this database for memory-optimized tables. What I first need to do is I need to add a memory-optimized data file group, and I need to add a container to this file group. Okay, and now I'm ready to start using in-memory OLTP. So I go to my database, and let me create a table here. So this is a fairly simple table, simplified sales orders table, which has an order ID, a date, and a status. It has a primary key, which is enforced using a hash index on order ID, and it has a secondary index, which is a non-clustered index on order date in descending order. And as you can see, I have here my option memory optimized on. So let me go and run this script. So and it is now compiling the DLL, creating the table. And I can see from my catalog views, in this case, sys.tables, I can see that indeed my table exists. We can see that this is indeed a memory optimized table, and the durability is schema and data, which is the default. And now, Darmadi, you were asking me, hey, where is this DLL located? So let me locate this DLL for you. So first, I'm going to look up the database ID, database ID 7, and then I will go to my file system. So what we have here is we are in the default data directory of the SQL Server instance. And there's a folder here called XTP, so let me go into the XTP folder. And let me go into the folder for my database. And what we can see here are a number of compilation artifacts. The main one is the actual DLL, which is loaded in memory for my table. But we have a number of additional compilation artifacts which are kept around for supportability purposes. In general, you as a user or as a developer, you don't need to worry about these files or maintaining these files or where they are. SQL Server manages these files for you.
I do have a question, though. Yeah. So the table is preloaded, created the DLL and things like that. What happened when I want to change the schema of the table, things like that?
When you want to change the schema, so SQL Server has the statement alter table, which you would generally use to change the schema.
Right.
Unfortunately, we do not yet support alter table with memory optimized tables in SQL Server 2014. It's on the roadmap for future releases. But what you will need to do in practice is to drop the table and recreate it.
Okay. So drop and recreate the table.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Awesome.
You do. Okay. So let me go back to the slides. So the next thing I want to talk about is the indexes, a little bit more detail about those. I teased already the two types of indexes. I want to say a little bit more. So first off, indexes on memory-optimized tables, they live only in memory. So there is no copy of the indexes on disk, like there is for the traditional disk-based tables. And in addition, there are no operations on indexes being logged in the transaction log. The transaction log will only contain the operations on the rows. Then what is also the case is that the indexes themselves do not contain the data rows. So with traditional disk-based tables, you have your clustered indexes, which are like a base table, which contain all the rows. You have non-clustered indexes, which also contain rows, maybe not all the columns from the table, but at least some columns. With index on memory optimized tables, this is not the case. So instead of having the data sit inside the index, what we do with memory optimized indexes is the index will contain a memory pointer to the base data row. So you traverse the index, you find the memory pointer, and you look up the row immediately. So this means that also every index is covering. So you don't need to worry about including indexes or anything like that. When using any index, you get to all the data in your database, in your table, rather. Now, as I briefly mentioned, there are two types of indexes. So we have a hash index and a non-clustered index. So the hash index is a completely new concept in SQL Server. What you need to do first when you specify the index, you need to specify this bucket count, right, which is where we usually recommend between 1 and 2 times the number of unique index keys And this bucket count, it has to do with the data structure. So internally, this is implemented as a hash table, and the bucket count is the number of buckets in the hash table. Now, what's important to keep in mind is that hash indexes are optimized for point lookups. So if you immediately know which identifier you're looking for, let's say you're looking for employee number 378, or you're looking for a specific social security number, something like that, then you would use a hash index for maximum performance. But if you want to do like a range lookup, like you want to look at a date range, or you want to get your rows back in a certain order, like you order by name or something like that, that's not supported by hash indexes. So for those scenarios, you will want to use a non-clustered index. And a non-clustered index on a memory optimized table is, from the usage point of view, pretty similar to a non-clustered index for traditional disk-based tables. The implementation is underneath is completely different. It is self-maintaining. The pages are variable size. The index are covering, et cetera, et cetera. But from a usage point of view, it is pretty similar. So you can do range lookups. You can look at a date range, like, for example, every sales order that was placed before December 1st, or let's say you want to get a batch of, let's say, sales orders by sales order ID, something like that. Even though these non-clustered indexes, they do also support point lookups, like hash indexes. Still, hash indexes perform better than non-clustered indexes for the point lookups. That is because with a hash index, in the best case, you hash your key, you jump into the index, and then immediately you can jump to your data row. Whereas with a non-clustered index, you need to traverse a tree to find your row. So if point lookups are in the performance critical path of your application, we recommend using hash indexes there.
Awesome. So now we have two types of indexes, hash and non-clustered index. Yeah. Can you show us how to use them? An example?
Yes, absolutely. So I have here, let me quickly again pull up the definition of my table. So I'm going to use the same table as I did before, the sales orders table. And we have here these two indexes. We have this non-clustered hash index, so the hash index on order ID, and we have a non-clustered index on order date, descending order. So for demonstration purposes, I'm just going to insert some sample data into my sales orders table. So these are five different sales orders. And now to show first the use of the hash index, I'm going to do a point lookup. So point lookup where I'm just going to retrieve the sales order with ID 5. So let me go and run this query. And as expected, I get my sales order number 4. And I can now look at the query plan. And as we can see, we have an index seek into my non-clustered hash index. And if we zoom in a little bit further, you see here that this is indeed a point lookup by looking at my seek predicate, which is this equality predicate. So it is an equality lookup on the number 4. And we look at the non-clustered index. So we have the non-clustered index on order date. So what I can do is I can select a date range I want to look up. So in this case, for example, I want to see all the orders placed on or after December 3rd. So let me go and run this query. And indeed, we see here 3 orders, December 3rd, 7th, and 8th. And if we look at the query plan, we see here an index seek indeed in this non-clustered index. And if we look in a little bit more detail, we see here that the index seek is on an inequality predicate, which means that this is a range lookup. So we're looking up a range of dates. And the second scenario for non-clustered indexes are the order by, when you want to get your rows in a particular sort order. So in this case, I want to retrieve my rows ordered by order date in descending order, so with the most recent orders first. So let me go and run this, and we can indeed see 8, 7, 3, 2, 1, so orders, sales orders in descending order. And when we look at this query plan, what we can see here is that we only have an index scan on in this particular index, so retrieving order date. And we know already that this index is ordered by order date in descending order. Because we know that, we don't need to sort the rows after retrieving them. We know we already retrieved the rows in the right order, so there's no expensive sort operator. Now, I can also show you the converse. If I want to say, for example, I want my rows ordered by order ID. Now you may think, hey, there is also an index on order ID, so hey, I can use that index to retrieve my orders in a particular order. However, the index on order ID is a hash index, and this hash index does not support ordered scans because, of course, a hash index is always in random order. So therefore, I need, after the index scan, I need a sort operator to figure out the order. So this query is going to be a lot more expensive. So if I want to run this kind of query on ordered by order ID, I would need to also specify a non-clustered index on order ID. I think that's it. Let me just clean up this portion of the demo and go back to the slides.
This is great. So you've shown us how to create the tables, and you also shown us how to create the two different types of indexes. Next thing that comes from the developer perspective is, how am I going to access those tables, right? So can you show us how to do that?
Yes. Well, first, let me give you a bit of an introduction here into the concepts. Mm-hmm. So indeed, you create your tables. Now you want to query those tables. I already showed you some ad hoc queries. But that's not always the most efficient way to access the tables. So you can access memory-optimized tables in two ways, with ad hoc queries and also with traditional views, stored procedures, etc. We call this traditional way of accessing interpreted T-SQL access, because you use interpreted T-SQL to access the tables and to execute the queries. But we also have a new concept called a natively compiled stored procedure, where we take existing T-SQL queries and we compile those to native code, to a DLL, for a really optimal execution. So because natively compiled stored procedures are new, I want to give a quick introduction into those. So first, this